I'm Dr. Shaili Mehta, and I'll be guiding you how to prepare for your general medicine. Now, general medicine is a major subject for MBBS students for their PG, but we are BDS students and we don't need to know everything for our NEET PG exams. It's good to know everything, but because of time restriction, we cannot study everything. So in this video, I'll tell you what should be your approach towards general medicine so you have a precise and a concise knowledge of this subject. So let's begin. So whenever you start preparing, you have certain doubts like what is the weightage of this subject, which books to refer for this subject, how much time should be allocated to this entire subject, and what should be the topic wise distribution, how many times should this subject be revised, when is the ideal time to start this subject, what are the important topics for your NEET exam, and what are the types of questions that are asked in your exam. So let's solve these doubts one by one. Now, when it comes to the weightage for your NEET MDS exam, the statistics that in the past few years shows that approximately 5 to 11 questions out of the total 240 questions are from general medicine. That accounts approximately 4% of your total paper. Now, general medicine is a subject where you can have a direct question or an indirect or a related question which will correlate two or three subjects. The next question is which books to refer for general medicine. So there are two standard textbooks. One is your Harrison's and the second one is Davidson's. Now these both textbooks are international authored books and it's usually used by your MBBS students. So in case you have read any other books during your BDS days, that's completely fine. Just stick to those books and make sure that you know them well. Now what should be the time allocated to this subject? So for this subject, you can complete general medicine within 10 to 15 days. And out of these 10-15 days, you can give around 4 to 6 days theory. Now basically, if your theory isn't that good or you're underconfident, you can increase your theory time. And when you are not confident about this subject, you can extend this with approximately around 5 days plus or minus. So that completely depending on your level of preparation, you can adjust this according to you. But this is the ideal time that works for most of the students, that you can work for around 10 to 15 days. Again, general medicine is a volatile subject. So if you want to take any breaks in between, you want to study general medicine for a week, then maybe you can start some other subject, then come back to general medicine. That's also fine. So that in your entire course, you can spend around 10 to 15 days for your general medicine. And when it comes to each topic wise distribution, you can give around 4 to 6 hours of theory reading and you can give around 8 to 10 hours of your MCQ practice. This is everything for your first reading. The next question is how many times this subject should be revised. So you all know general medicine is a very volatile subject. So it is advised that you revise it around 4 to 8 times depending on the time availability. Now this 4 to 8 times does not mean you start today and you complete 4 times today. If you start today, you do your first revision exactly according to the previous slide. Then you wait for a week, go for your second revision. Then wait for a month, then go for your third revision, and consecutively whenever you have your exams, you keep revising it. That's how you complete in your entire course of preparation. At least you should revise general medicine for 4 times. The next time is what is the ideal time to start the subject. So if you divide your preparation into 4 halves, the third quarter can be given to your general medicine. That is approximately after completing 10 to 12 subjects. Now for general medicine, it's advised that you study medicine after completing your pharmacology and your microbiology, because these two subjects will have a lot of correlation with your general medicine. So once you are done with those two subjects, you can start with your general medicine. Now we'll talk about the important topics for general medicine. So whenever you start the subject of general medicine, there are two things that you need to know. That for general medicine, it is expected that you should know the diagnosis of the disease and the treatment. That's everything that's general medicine demands. So first is infection. So when we move on to infection, the first and the most important infection would be your tuberculosis. Then comes your leprosy, then actinomycosis, then you have syphilis, then you have clostridium infections, and the last one would be a cornibacterium. Apart from these infections, you can have a little bit knowledge about the rest of the infection as well. When the next is viral infection. So the first is HIV/AIDS. So for HIV, you need to know the bacteria, the virus that causes the disease, the exact mechanism or the structure of the virus. So you have GP40, you have GP120 on the surface, how it binds to your CD4, then what is selective tropism, then according to CD4 count, your how the disease is divided, and then you need to know the CDC classification. When it comes to HIV, the drugs for HIV is also important. That entire classification, which is reverse transcriptase inhibitor, which is non-reverse transcriptase inhibitor, that's important to know. The next is your HIV, your HSV, that is your herpes simplex virus. So there are total 8 virus. You need to know all of them. Then you need to know the corresponding other names. Suppose Epstein-Barr virus, so which type of your herpes virus. Then you also have to know that herpes virus 8 causes Kaposi sarcoma. What does Epstein-Barr virus cause? So all those things are important to know. Most important in herpes would be your herpes simplex infection and your herpes zoster infection. Here you need to know the diagnosis, the test, microscopic appearance, and your medicines. Next, we move on to central nervous system. Here you need to know a gist of the hemorrhages, first of all, what is the common cause of hemorrhages. Suppose you have subdural, epidural hemorrhage, so that's important here. Second important part would be to know about epilepsy. So epilepsy, you need to know the classification of epilepsy, what exactly happened, how's the aura in your petit mal epilepsy. Then you need to know the exact drug, that is your drug of choice for each type of epilepsy. So if you have petit mal epilepsy, which type of drug will you use? So that's important to know. Next, we come to Parkinsonism. So you need to know Parkinsonism. Then you need to know the drugs that can be used for Parkinsonism. Then when it comes to facial nerve and your trigeminal neuralgia, for facial nerve specifically, you need to know the difference between upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron, the difference between the lesions of both. Then when it comes to your central nervous system, it's again important to know the miscellaneous diseases that involve your central nervous system. For example, you have certain you if you have a trauma, then what will be the effect of the same injury on your brain? So these things can be asked. Again, here the optical tract is very important. In the recent NEET, they asked direct questions that if the left central part of the optical path is damaged, so which vision is gone, your peripheral or your central, your left or right? So your optical path and which area gives what kind of vision is important to know. Now we move on to GIT, liver and kidneys. First is acid-base balance. So for this, you need to know the normal carbon dioxide level, the bicarbonate level in your body. Then you need to know what causes metabolic acidosis, your metabolic alkalosis, respiratory acidosis, and alkalosis. So they will give you a question, and then you have to guess whether it's metabolic acidosis, alkalosis, or respiratory alkalosis or acidosis. Next is hepatitis. So all the types of hepatitis are important. Here you have to know the mode of transmission. For example, A is to fecal oral, B is through blood transfusion. So all these things are important. Again, the name of the different viruses. So here you need to know the structure of virus, which is your RNA and which is your DNA virus. So one important modification here will be to know the different names of the virus as well. For example, hepatitis D is also known as Delta virus. So every virus might have a different name. You need to know that. There's a wonderful graph given in your microbiological book. So here they can ask you that in the acute phase, which antibody is seen in higher quantity, or which surface antigen is seen in case of hepatitis, in case of acute infection, in case of the patient has taken any vaccines for hepatitis B. So what will be the blood picture basically in under such conditions? So that's important to know. There's a beautiful diagram given. It's a chart that's given in your microbiological book, so you can refer to that. Next is nephrotic syndrome. So here you need to know the range. What causes your liver failure? What causes your kidney failure? So that's important to know. Again, one important part is your Kohn syndrome. Then you have Helicobacter pylori, which basically deals with your ulcers. So what is the antibiotic you can give for ulcers, and what are the other medication you can give for H. pylori? Next is your urinary tract infection, your Dubin-Johnson syndrome. Along with Dubin-Johnson syndrome, it's important to know the different types of jaundice. You have hemolytic, obstructive. So what increases? Suppose you have your alkaline phosphatase increase in some, decrease in some. What is the effect on your stereobilirubin? Then what is your effect on urobilinogen? So all these things are important to know when it comes to jaundice. There's a good table given in your textbook, so you can refer to that textbook, which basically tells you the different types of jaundice. Next is your renal stone. Then you have appendicitis. Then for renal failure, it's important to know what are the causes of renal failure and what are the drugs that can be used in case of renal failure, along with knowing the signs and symptoms that can give you an indication that the liver is failing. The most important is, of course, it causes edema. Now we move on to hematology. So first is hemophilia. You need to know the types of hemophilia, diagnosis of hemophilia, difference between the diagnosis of type A and type B, the treatment of hemophilia. So what factors can be given for type A, type B, and what are the cryoprecipitates can be given? Then what are the other alternative substitutes that can be given in case of hemophilia? For hemophilia, the symptoms, signs and symptoms will be variable according to the intensity of the disease. So depending on the factor that's present in the host will show the symptoms. So that classification you need to know. Second is anemia. So you need to know your iron deficiency, megaloblastic, your folic acid, vitamin B12 deficiency. Then you have your pernicious anemia. That's again B12 deficiency. So all these should be thorough. Along with that, your three indexes, that your MCV, MCH, all that should be thorough, along with the unit and the number, the exact range and the unit. So that's important to diagnose whether the patient has anemia or not. Then the biochemistry level, I mean the normal iron concentration in human body. Then you should know in iron deficiency anemia, the total iron binding capacity increases or decreases, and the total transferrin increases or decreases. So these things are important to know. You can make a table for this, writing for iron deficiency, what biochemical changes are seen, what is the microscopic picture, something like that you can do. Next is your leukemia. So all four types of leukemia, your AML, your ALL, CML and CLL, everything is important, but you don't need to go in detail. For each leukemia, there are around 5 to 7 important points. You just need to know those 5 to 7 points, then you're good to go then. Next is your thalassemia. So you need to know the major thalassemia, minor thalassemia, what can be used as a treatment for thalassemia. It cannot be treated, but what is the transfusion that can be given for thalassemia. Then you have DCI, your DIC, sorry. So DIC is not a very important topic. You just have to know a gist about it. Then we move on to your endocrinology part. So first is diabetes mellitus, goes without saying, very important classification, type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, and the miscellaneous type of diabetes, your gestational induced diabetes, and all the other types of diabetes are important for you to know. Then the drugs can be used, the diagnosis, you need to know about diabetic coma. Then you know about need to know about diabetic gangrene, that will be a part of your general surgery. Then when it comes to diabetes, you need to know your GTT, that is glucose tolerance test, exact measurement, how it is done, everything about GTT. Next is your hyperthyroidism. So you need to know the difference between hyperthyroidism, hypothyroidism, difference in the treatment, difference in the diagnosis, difference in the signs and symptoms of both. Then there is hyperparathyroidism. So you need to know for thyroidism and parathyroidism, you need to know the causes as well. So it can be either pathological or any overgrowth or hypertrophy or any tumor that might be associated. So you have hyperparathyroidism. So that is basically that disturbs your calcium metabolism. So that can lead to rickets. So rickets is again related to your vitamin D also. So when it comes to vitamin D, you need to know the causes that can lead to vitamin D deficiency, the signs and symptoms and the treatment, the exact doses, and what is the common or the normal level that is present in human body. For tumor lysis syndrome and pheochromocytoma, it's not very important to know these things, but if you have a gist idea of it, and if the question comes, you will be able to answer. So you can just know what it is, don't go into details. So the next thing is your respiratory system. So first is obstructive and restrictive disease. You need to know the difference between the two, which diseases come under obstructive and which come under restrictive. This part will be covered in detail in your physiology. Next, we move on to asthma. So for asthma, you need to know the cause, the etiopathogenesis, that is your exact etiopathogenesis of type 1 hypersensitivity reaction, and you need to know diagnosis and treatment. In case you have a question on status asthmaticus, you need to know the exact drug and the doses and the frequency at which it is administered, and the management of asthma in a dental chair is very important. Next, when it comes to COPD, so you need to know COPD in and out, along with knowing about emphysema, then your chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis. So So for all the diseases that I just said, you need to know if there is a change in the sound. So for example, you have certain sound like wheeze, stridor. So in which condition these sounds are seen? Then the second, some cases you have the trachea shift to the side of lesion, and in some cases it remains in the same position, and in some cases it moves to the opposite side. So in which condition what happens? The position of trachea is important. The next important thing is the color of sputum. So in case you have any disease, you respiratory disease, so color of sputum changes. Then the next thing is the shape of the chest. So you have a pigeon shaped chair, a funnel shaped chest. So all these things, in which conditions these things are seen. Next we come to pneumonia. So the different stages of pneumonia, you have all the stages of your hepatization. Basically your liver, your lungs starts looking like your liver. So you have red hepatization, gray hepatization. So all those things are important. The state your you have your lobar pneumonia. So all those things you need to know in detail. Next is tuberculosis. So tuberculosis goes without saying, very important. So the mechanism, like the mechanism by which the bacteria enters the body and causes the disease, that's your pathophysiology. Then your drug of choice, entire regime. What are the drugs that you will give in your multi-drug resistant tuberculosis? And then what is the drug that you will give in extreme drug resistant tuberculosis? What are the new drugs that can be used for tuberculosis? Respiratory failure is again one important topic. So here a lot of questions are not asked, but they can ask you what are the causes and what is the exact mess. Suppose it's because of a respiratory alkalosis or acidosis, so they might ask you the exact units, or what is in case of respiratory failure, so what should be the breath rate or when it decreases. So these kind, but it's not a very important topic. You can have a gist or a crisp idea about respiratory failure. Next is your cardiovascular system. So your first is heart failure. For heart failure, you need to know the degrees of your AV block. So heart failure first will be the causes, then your diagnosis and treatment. Now when it comes to the heart failure, you need to know AV block, degree of AV blocks, the sound murmurs that can occur. Then the next topic we move on to is your myocardial infarction. So for myocardial infarction, you need to know the etiology. Then which side is commonly involved, which your cardiac vein is commonly involved in your myocardial infarction, which side is more frequently used in your involved in your myocardial infarction. You need to know the ECG changes, then your biochemical changes, which are the indicators showing that it's a myocardial infarction. And in cases you have troponins, certain troponins that increase in case of myocardial infarction. So you need to know at which stage or how many, after how many hours each troponin or each biochemical reaction will occur. Next is your valvular disease. So here you have all your valvular disease that play a very important role. Along with your valvular disease, you also have your childhood or innate diseases, that is your tetralogy or fallot. Then you have your ASD, VSD, all those things are very important. So you need to know whether it's right to left shunt or left to right shunt. Then whether it causes cyanosis, does not cause cyanosis. When we come to valvular disease, so the most important is aortic regurgitation. So for all the types, there are four types. So you have either regurgitation or stenosis. So for all these, there are certain signs that occurs. You need to know the sign. Then what is the exact sign and symptom that occurs? You need to know the mechanism, that suppose you have a mitral stenosis, so where is the blood actually getting accumulated and where is the blood not reaching properly. So that will help you to understand all the signs and symptoms. There are different names given to all the signs. So, and there are different types of pulse or your murmurs that can be seen. So you have pulses bifringens, then you have other types of pulses. So what is the exact relation of your valvular disease to the pulse and why it occurs? That's important to know. Next, we move on to endocarditis. So endocarditis it was a very important topic in your third year. So entrance is the same. You need to know which valve is commonly involved. Then in case of myocardial infarction, which valve is involved? Then these can be asked you as a fact-based question. So the commonly involved valve, the commonly involved your bacteria or your entire microbiology, that which bacteria or microorganism causes specific community there. Then the stages of formation of endocarditis and the diagnosis of endocarditis. When it comes to dental part, here it's important to know that in case of endocarditis, what are the precautions you will take in your dental chair. Then CPR is a topic that you should just have an idea about it. Not a lot of questions have been asked from this topic. So now we move on to the type of question that are asked in your NEET exam. The first type of question is a single best answer where you have four options and one of them is the correct answer. First is a case-based question. So here you might have a case saying that the patient, they might give you the levels of CO2, they might give you the level of bicarbonate, and they will ask you whether the patient is suffering for metabolic alkalosis or metabolic acidosis. Or they might give you a condition where they might describe the symptoms of the patient, how the patient basically had an epileptic attack. Then based on that, you have to guess which type of epilepsy is it. Or either they will give you the type of epilepsy, then you have to answer the drug of choice for the same. That's a case-based question. Second is a fact-based question. So here you can have a question like, they can ask you the concentrations of various acids or bases. They can ask you the normal values, like for example, in case of jaundice, which in case of obstructive jaundice, whether alkaline phosphatase increases, decreases. So what is the effect on the color of stool when you have obstructive jaundice, when you have hemolytic jaundice? So all these are fact-based questions. Next is a concept-based question. So here you might have questions related to your stride, Wieder, color of your sputum, then exact mechanism of action, how does a wheeze occur, then what is in which condition the trachea shifted to right, left, all those things. Then what are the changes in your ECG when you have a myocardial infarction? Or you can have a question saying that you have a first degree heart block, second degree AV block basically. Then you can have a question here on your jugular venous pressure. Even that's a very important part, and that can be asked to you as a concept based question. So for numerical or a value based question, it might be related to your acid base values or your normal concentration. For example, if you have anemia, they might ask you MCH, MCV or all those things. So that can be a numerical based value where you just have to identify. You don't have to actually calculate anything in general medicine. Next is a picture based question. So general medicine involves a lot of graphs. They can give you either a graph on obstructive disease or restrictive disease. They can give you a graph of GTT, or they can give you an ECG or your venous or your jugular venous pressure, and they can ask questions on that. Next is a true or false type of question. So you have a statement and you have to state whether the statement is true or false. That's the pattern of your NEET MDS exams. So that's how you prepare for your general medicine. Don't worry, there's a common fear amongst all students that they want to complete general medicine, but trust me, it's seriously not possible to complete entire medicine. It's a huge subject. So whatever is there in your dental curriculum, you have to be thorough with it. It's a little volatile, but with a little bit of practice, you can master it. So I hope this video has helped you, and all the best, guys. If you have any further doubts, please mention it in the comment section and we will solve it. If you want to know more about tips and tricks on how to crack your NEET and AIIMS exam, you can follow me on Instagram. My handle name is Dr. Shelly Mehta. If you want to see more of these kind of videos, please do like, share and subscribe to our channel. Hit the bell icon to get a notification whenever we upload a new video. Don't forget to download the app. The link is given in the description box. Thank you.